Canada, hello, hello, come in.
Simon's talking on neoliberalism and discourse, politics between post-structuralism and political economy, just by way of introduction, not that he needs it, I think. Simon's written extensively on...
Come in, come in. Come in, come in.
Have a seat. Simon's written extensively on neoliberalism and on anarchist approaches to geography. He's a publishing machine, so just to give you an indication of some of his recent publications, The Discourse of Neoliberalism, An Anatomy of a Powerful Idea, a recent book, Violent Neoliberalism, Development, Discourse and Dispossession in Canada,
Cambodia.
And a range of, is it three edited books on anarchist geographies?
Yeah.
And then the recently published Handbook of Neoliberalism with Kean Birch as well. And also, as you may be aware, Scheiß auf den Neoliberalismus, or Fuck Neoliberalism, which has gone viral and was mentioned very unfavourably in the Australian conservative flagship journal Quadrant recently, which I think is probably a badge of honour. Anyhow, at least in this company. So you're very welcome, Simon. Simon's going to speak for about 50 minutes and then there'll be time for questions and comments. So, open to Simon.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Damien, and for setting this up and making the time during your off season. And for all of you for being here today, I know it's classes aren't in session, so you've come out of your way to be here. So, I'm here to speak for 50 minutes and happy to answer your questions afterwards as best as I can. Okay, so neoliberalism and discourse, politics between post-structuralism and political economy. So, I mean, basically what I'm setting out to do in this talk is to think about the kinds of linkages that exist between political economic approaches to neoliberalism and post-structuralist approaches to neoliberalism. And there's been, in the literature, there seems to be somewhat of a divide still between these two approaches and some literature even saying quite explicitly that the two have a divergence that they can't actually fit together. And I'm trying to think through some of the ways in which I think we can make sense of neoliberalism using either of these frames. And in fact, if we bring these two frames together, then we can start to think of neoliberalism and discourse as being an integral sort of process, if you will, where neoliberalism is discursive, of course, but in thinking of a discursive view of neoliberalism, this is not to remove the materialism of this idea as well. So just to flag that discourse meant in that particular sense. Okay, so the rupture that exists in current theorizations of neoliberalism is at least to some degree framed by this false dichotomy that I just mentioned. So between those studies that have been influenced in particular by Michel Foucault in emphasizing governmentality, and those studies that foreground the ideas of a hegemonic ideology, drawing influence in particular from Karl Marx. Yet in a conversation with Foucault, Gerard Roulette once asked, but does this mean that in a certain way Marx is at work in your own methodology? To which Foucault responded, yes, absolutely. R. James Goldstein's contention that in reply to Marx's famous thesis that philosophers have hitherto only interpreted the world when the real point is to change it, Foucault would no doubt have argued that our constant task must be to keep changing our minds. So this seems like a particularly apt sort of framing in terms of identifying the false dichotomy that seems to persist within studies of neoliberalism. In this talk, I don't presume to work through all the tensions that inevitably arise between post-structuralist and Marxian accounts, yet to be very clear, nor do I seek to. My purpose is much more modest than that, and in the spirit of changing our minds, I instead seek to shine some new light on a factional issue in the interest of opening up new debates and recasting existing ones in such a way that might lead to a more flexible and circuitous understanding of neoliberalism. So within the broader literature, my approach is signaled by the cultural turn of both international political economy and economic geography. The emphasis on cultural approaches to understanding economies and their geographies, or what Andrew Sayre once called a cultural economy, envisions culture as a bottom-up method of analysis, augmenting the more traditional top-down approach of political economy. This shift in focus recognizes the meanings, or that meanings within social practices and relations, and what they have for those situated within them, and further that economic agents do not merely submit to the abstract category of market. Rather, their economic world is infused with contestation over what constitutes the market slash state and the rules and conventions according to which actors should operate. Equally, it presumes a degree of reflexivity among political economists, recognizing that their theories are reproduced in specific space-time contexts as situated knowledges, to use Haraway's term. From a feminist perspective, Risha Nagar and her co-authors have argued that political economic geography must necessarily be extended even further to begin accounting for the gendered spatial dimensions that underpin local come global economic processes, and particularly the analytic erasure of the role of feminized subjects and the informal work that they perform. Congruent to this project is the need for future studies to cut across scales, bringing together perspectives from both the global north and the global south and highlighting the relationship between particularized and generalized economic processes. So this is a call that's been answered fairly recently by a geographer named Matt Spark and his co-authors, who attempted to model a more socially, culturally, and internationally inclusive critique of neoliberal globalization for economic geographers through an evaluation of the degree to which criticisms of neoliberalism that were articulated at the World Social Forum facilitated the inclusion of excluded subjects, spaces, and informal critical political economy or into the sort of formal economic directives. So in short, they conclude that a culturally informed political economy has a major role to play in developing politically enabling understandings of the entanglements of power in an increasingly interdependent neoliberal world. So implicit within these notions of a culturally informed political economy, then, is an appreciation of post-structuralist critique, which renowned political economist Robert Cox makes explicit by adopting post-structuralism's classic critique that all power and knowledge as a couplet is for someone, serving some purpose, and any notion of a disinterested objectivity is actually illusory. Melissa Wright has neatly summarized post-structuralism's position on objectivity, suggesting not only is the idea that we can grasp meaning through language of fiction, albeit a necessary one, but so also is the idea that we can know, conceptualize, or represent original meaning through scientific inquiry. In other words, as Foucault demonstrated through his dismantling of the subject as a self-knowing and autonomous actor, human reality is a protean landscape produced through innumerable signifying activities whose origins can never be located through historical, philosophical, or scientific inquiry. Post-structuralism thus advances a constructivist position, which deconstructs the truth claims of an objective science by showing the radical historical specificity and so contestability of every layer of the onion of scientific and technological constructions. So those are Haraway's words. Which in turn then dismantles the possibility of any apparatus that might be used to effectively talk about a so-called real world. The current influence of neoliberal reason, to use Jamie Peck's term, offers no exception to the notion that power operates in a field of knowledge serving some purpose, and through such understandings we can begin to open a window onto how post-structuralism might be able to accommodate the political economic appraisal that neoliberalism is an elite project concerned with the reconstitution of class power, which you probably recognize as David Harvey's argument. So in recognition of the cultural turn then, and informed by both political economy and post-structuralist critiques, in this talk I want to set out to argue in favor of understanding neoliberalism as a particular discourse. I argue that conceptualizing neoliberalism as discourse enables a potential merger of political economic and post-structuralist approaches by recognizing the importance of both critical perspectives without actually privileging either. How we understand the translation of global capital across various spaces and cultural contexts, and in particular how we interpret the fluidity between those who produce and those who are constrained by neoliberal discourse is a paramount consideration if we are to counter problematic notions of neoliberalism as an unstoppable force. The latest wave of neoliberal rollout following the financial crisis that began in 2008 makes countering this juggernaut view even more urgent, as what Rieger Hendriksen and James Sidaway have dubbed a neoliberalism 3.0. And this neoliberalism 3.0, they say, begins seeking out new paths and extensions of power, which of course then makes it all the more critical to find alternatives and to present a countering discourse to it. In tracing the contours of neoliberalism as discourse then, I want to start with a discussion that outlines the lack of consensus in defining neoliberalism that has contributed to misunderstanding between scholars, and then moving forward to discuss how various interpretations of neoliberalism might actually be sutured together. So in short, my primary purpose with this talk is to contribute to theorizations that might enable more forceful critiques of the power of neoliberalism. And I think a discourse approach moves our theorizations forward through an understanding that neoliberalism is neither built from the top down, as in Marxian understandings of ideological hegemony, nor from the bottom up, as in post-structuralist notions of governmentality. Rather, neoliberalism is instead recognized as a mutable, inconsistent, and variegated process that circulates through the discourses it constructs, justifies, and defends. There is, no doubt, a terrible danger in a dematerialized post-structuralism, and I set out to argue that post-structuralist thought need not be separated from the material. My purpose is not to replace neoliberalism as monolithism with an immaterial discursivism. Rather, the version of neoliberalism as discourse that I present acknowledges the inherent transitory nature of the social, but remains grounded by recognizing both the Marxian lineage of post-structuralist critique and through an understanding of materialism as an archaeology of knowledge, to use Foucault's term. And this archaeology of knowledge necessarily couples discourse with practice. What is at stake then is an understanding of neoliberalism that is duly aware of both structure and agency, thus capturing the discursive production of neoliberalism. So, towards a neoliberal discourse, and in this part of the talk, I want to talk about the four sort of iterations of neoliberalism in theory. So the idea of an ideological hegemonic project, the idea of neoliberalism as policy and program, an idea of neoliberalism as a particular version of a state form, and an idea of neoliberalism as governmentality. So from initial explorations concerned with the implications for state reform, the expansion of neoliberalism into a field of academic inquiry has been meteoric. Scholars are now examining the relationships between neoliberalism and everything from cities to citizenship, sexuality to subjectivity, and development to discourse, to name but a few. Concomitant to such theoretical expansion, consensus on what is actually meant by neoliberalism has diminished significantly. Consequently, some commentators have demonstrated considerable anxiety over the potential explanatory power of the concept itself, labeling neoliberalism a necessary illusion, to use Noel Castries' term, or even suggesting that there's no such thing, which was said once by Clive Barnett, both geographers. Drawing on J.K. Gibson Graham's misgivings over the discursive fetishization of capital, these reservations are anxious about how pervasive neoliberalism has become in academic writing, and are equally concerned about the monolithic appearance of neoliberalism owing to its characterization as an expansive, dynamic, and self-reproducing entity. These critiques offer an important call for further reflection, as it is vital to challenge the neoliberalism as monolithism argument for failing to recognize the protean and processual character of space and time. Similarly, by constituting an external and supposedly omnipresent neoliberalism, we neglect the internal constitution, local variability, and the role that the social and individual agency play in reproducing, facilitating, and circulating neoliberalism. Such criticisms have triggered an increasing propensity in the literature to replace discussions of neoliberalism with a new language of neoliberalization. And this idea of neoliberalization acknowledges multiplicity, complexity, variegation, and contextual specificity. So a lot of this work is going on within geography, but also happening outside of the discipline of geography as well. But probably for obvious reasons, it's kind of geographers who have been driving this kind of agenda. As a protean process, then, neoliberalization is considered to materialize very differently as a series of hybridized or mutated forms of neoliberalism, contingent upon existing historical contexts, geographical landscapes, institutional legacies, and embodied subjectivities. On the other hand, some have called for a moment of pause, suggesting that we should be wary of an overly concrete or introspective analysis of the local, as such accounts inadequately attend to the principal attributes and meaningful bonds of neoliberalism as a global project. The larger conversation that neoliberalism provokes is regarded as imperative in connecting similar patterns of experience across space, which may serve as a potential for building solidarities. Thus, neoliberalism as a concept allows poverty and inequality experienced across multiple sites to find a point of similarity, whereas disarticulation undermines efforts to build and sustain shared aims of resistance beyond a micropolitics of the local. Accordingly, conceptualizing neoliberalism requires an appreciation of the elaborate and fluctuating interchange between between local and extra-local forces which are at work within the global political economy. Ai Hua Ong corroborates this notion by conceptualizing Big N neoliberalism as a fixed set of attributes with predetermined outcomes, while Small N neoliberalism, she says, operates in practice as a logic of governing that mitigates and is selectively taken up in diverse political contexts. In this light, Jamie Peck and Adam Tickell propose a processual conception of neoliberalization as both an out-there and in-here phenomenon whose effects are necessarily variegated and uneven, but the incidence and diffusion of which may present clues to a pervasive metalogic. Like globalization, neoliberalization should be understood as a process, not as an end state. Thus, neoliberalism come neoliberalization can be viewed as a plural set of ideas emanating from both everywhere and nowhere within diffused loci of power. The inability to straightforwardly align neoliberalism to particular individuals, organizations, or states, and the further recognition that there is no pure or paradigmatic version of neoliberalism, but rather a series of geopolitically distinct and institutionally effective hybrids, plays a significant role in the difficulty of realizing consensus on a conceptual definition of neoliberalism in general. So neoliberalism, it would seem, is simply too nebulous to isolate or pin down. Nonetheless, following Kevin Ward and Kim England, within the existing literature, we can identify four different understandings of neoliberalism. So again, you can see those here, and this is drawing from the sort of taxonomy that England and Ward have put together. But also, they add a fourth component to the sort of three components that were previously identified by Wendy Larner in her work. So the first, neoliberalism as an ideological hegemonic project. So within this understanding, the thought is that elite actors and dominant groups are organized around a transnational class-based alliance and have the capacity to project and circulate a coherent program of interpretations and images of the world onto others. This is not merely the subordination to particular coercive impositions, but it also involves a degree of willing consent. So attention is focused on the people and ideas behind the conceptual origin of neoliberalism, as well as those who are at the forefront of its adoption in a range of geographical settings. So again, going to Gramsci, thinking of hegemony as both top-down and bottom-up in that sort of sense. The second formation of neoliberalism in the literature that we can see is neoliberalism as a policy and program. And within this frame of reference, the focus is on the transfer of ownership from the state or public holdings to the private sector or corporate interests, which necessarily involves a conceptual reworking of the meaning of that these categories hold. The understanding itself here is premised on the idea that opening collectively held resources to market mediation engenders greater efficiency. And the usual motifs under which such policy and program are advanced include things like privatization, deregulation, liberalization, depoliticization, and monetarism. The third, neoliberalism as a state form. In this understanding, neoliberalism is considered as a process of transformation that states purposefully engage to remain economically competitive within a transnational playing field of similarly minded states. This is thought to involve both a qualitative access of destruction and discreditation, whereby the state capacities and potentialities are rolled back, and a qualitative access of construction and consolidation, wherein reconfigured institutional mediations, economic management systems, and invasive social agendas centered on urban order, surveillance, immigration issues, and policing are rolled out. So this is from Jamie Peck and Adam Tickell's work, where they identify a rollback and a rollout neoliberalism, largely in response then to this idea of how the state should be formed. The fourth theme within the literature that we can identify is neoliberalism as governmentality. And this interpretation of neoliberalism centers on acknowledging a processual character wherein neoliberalism's articulation with existing circumstances comes through the endlessly unfolding failures and successes in the relations between peoples and their socially constructed realities as they are reimagined, reinterpreted, and reassembled to influence the forms of knowledge through the conduct of conduct, to use Foucault's term. This understanding implies power as a complex yet very specific form centering on knowledge production through the ensemble of relationalities, strategies, technologies, and techniques concerning the mentality of rule. These productions of knowledge allow for the decentering of government through the active role of auto-regulated or auto-correcting selves who facilitate the idea of governance at a distance. Thus, the internal dynamics of neoliberalism in this understanding are underpinned by the unquestioned common sense, which means quite literally then a sense held in common. So given that scholars of neoliberalism typically amalgamate two or more of these views on neoliberalism, so we won't often find any single scholar who says neoliberalism is just number three or just number two, or there's a lot of creative sort of playing around with these various formations of neoliberalism. So I think then this interpretive quality actually reinforces the argument that I want to make, and that is an argument that each reading of neoliberalism does not actually exist in isolation, but is actually connected to and recursive of the alternative views. Recent contributions demonstrate a growing readiness then to sift through the methodological, epistemological, and ontological differences between these four definitions, and even if particular, this is happening even if particular views on neoliberalism still come through. So with most scholars, you can usually identify they probably fit mostly within one of these categories, but are speaking to at least some extent to some of the other categories. Yet it's, I think, still somewhat rare to see category one come together with category four in a relatively coherent sort of manner. And that's where some of the anxiety of people like Noel Castry and Clive Barnett comes from, is in particular the idea of a hegemonic project. How can that be reconciled with a view of governmentality? Okay, so I think important middle ground inquiries are emerging where scholars are beginning to develop more amalgamated interpretations, yet a truly hybridized approach that attempts to synthesize or at least reconcile all of these divergent conceptualizations in any sort of sustained sense, these are much less common. A series of progress reports, again by a geographer, Matt Spark, they offer a notably rare exception. So in Progress in Human Geography, Matt Spark has published three articles that try to bring these themes together, where he's talking about different iterations of neoliberalism. And if you take all three pieces together, you can see this sort of broader view come into focus. Linking such divergent theorizations is, of course, no small task, as it is one that necessarily involves reconciling a Marxian political economy perspective of hegemonic ideology with post-structuralist conceptualizations of governmentality, where policy and program along with state form approaches fall somewhere in between. So for Clive Barnett, the potential of such an exercise is entirely unconvincing, as the two intellectual projects imply different models of the nature of explanatory concepts, of causality and determination, of social relations and agency, and different normative understandings of political power. So for Barnett, he argues that we should not finesse these differences away by presuming that the two approaches converge around a common real-world referent. Similarly, Noel Castry disavows what he calls the both-and agenda for the intractable inability to fix neoliberalism's meanings with real-world reference, stemming from the use of multiple definitions where the real world can only partially function as a court of appeal to resolve competing claims as to what is or is not neoliberal in degree or kind. So those are Castry's words. Castry uses the peculiar analogy of water to illustrate his point. Taking its meaning, the meaning of water that is, from a positive scientific sort of view of water having forms of gas, liquid, and solid, yet always remaining water wherever and whenever it is. So this comparison, however, belies a faux realism as it fails to consider how different languages, cultures, and individuals may have very different meanings for and understandings of the idea of water in general. So the idea that Inuit people have hundreds of words for the English language equivalent of snow is an anthropological myth, but it is nonetheless instructive of how the real world can only be viewed as little more than a semiotic construction where even something seemingly as universal as water may be reduced to competing claims as to what it is or is not in degree or kind. In other words, Castry engages a very narrowly and privately defined understanding of the real, which is mobilized as a cipher for his own idealism. England and Ward are far more sympathetic, where the trick in reconciling a political economy approach with a post-structuralist perspective is to acknowledge the power of neoliberalism without reinscribing it as a unitary, hegemonic project. But while England and Ward acknowledge that an assemblage of ideas generally fall under the category of neoliberal, they seem to overlook the possibility of understanding hegemony in the Gramscian sense of neither unitary or monolithic, but itself rife with contingencies, ruptures, and contradictions. So indeed, such variegated hegemonies play themselves out as neoliberalizations in a myriad of situated contexts. Such recognition of the hegemony of neoliberalism, or more appropriately, the hegemonies of neoliberalizations, as in Marxian approaches, is not at all inconsistent with post-structuralist-inspired notions of governmentality. Rather, what Foucault called the conduct of conduct is actually part of how neoliberal hegemonic constellations have assembled themselves, particularly through networks of think tanks whose embodied participants can be broadly conceived of as a transnational capitalist class. These situated actors face various forms of incorporation and resistance, dependent upon context, and thus mutate their approaches to neoliberal governance accordingly. As such, the notion of hegemony is not diametrically opposed to a more nuanced understanding of neoliberalization, nor is there an insurmountable disjuncture between the four forms of neoliberalism. These theoretical strands are reconcilable insofar as the hegemonic project has particular policy goals that reshape state formations, making them differently powerful in the process. Simultaneously, principles from different systems of thought are combined into one coherent ideology, which becomes common sense, allowing governance as a distance to operate. In turn, the circle is closed and indeed thrown back on itself by individual subjects who reconstitute hegemony through the coalescence of circumstances of their everyday lives. So thus the productive power of neoliberal ideology constitutes and constrains, but does not determine. Instead, as a process of becoming through which one simultaneously obtains the construction of the constitution of a subjectivity and undergoes subjection, neoliberal subjectification works on individuals who are rendered as subjects and subjected to relations of power through discourse. Accordingly, neoliberalism, I argue, can be productively understood as a circulating discourse. And if that was a mouthful, and it was for me, this is basically what it looks like. This is what I'm conceptualizing in the way that these forms actually come together. So that's what I want to talk about now, is articulating post-structuralist and Marxian political economic perspectives in an attempt to try and suture these themes together. So, materialism, discursive performativity, and where I think this leads to the future for neoliberalism. Precisely because discourse itself can be defined as a group of statements belonging to a single system or formulation, neoliberalism, if we understand it as a discourse, is able to articulate a synthesis of complementarities between theoretical positions that are seemingly mismatched. Yet there can be little doubt that some scholars will retain their hardened epistemological positions and want to continue to see these interwoven strands of neoliberalism as separate and distinct. For example, from a post-structuralist perspective, this model of neoliberalism as discourse can be criticized for assuming a Marxian political economy-inspired structure insofar as it still recognizes the hierarchy behind and involved in the construction of neoliberalism as an ideological hegemonic project. When I first showed this image to Jamie Peck, he said, well, there's going to be a critique that you position the hegemonic idea at the top and the governmentality idea at the bottom. And so my response is, you can turn this diagram any which way you want to. I've positioned the words this way, making it easiest to read, but if you'd like to flip it over and read it upside down, it still works the same because all the arrows are flowing together, right? From a post-structuralist perspective, it might be criticized for assuming a Marxian political economy-inspired sort of structure. But the question I would ask then is, when is post-structuralist critique actually ever beyond structure? As Jacques Rancière argues, critique acknowledges something's existence, but in order to confine it within limits. And accordingly, post-structuralism necessarily acknowledges structuralism and so presupposes structure. Moreover, there is no single definition of post-structuralism, no agreed-upon methodological or theoretical imperatives. Instead, it refers to conceptual signposts collected from a diverse set of ideas based on the writings of authors like Foucault, Deleuze, and Derrida. And indeed, it is inconsistent with post-structuralist concepts to codify itself in any concretized manner. The term post-structuralism itself was first applied to Derrida's practice of deconstruction in the 1970s, yet he showed some degree of discomfort with this label, suggesting it was a word unknown in France until his return from the United States. Instead, Derrida actually spoke of himself as both a communist and a Marxist, where in his book Spectres of Marx, he clearly exemplified his position on the ongoing relevance of Marx and his belief that we must continue to sift through Marx's possible legacies. Deleuze also suggested that he remained Marxist, having been intrigued by Marx's analysis of capitalism as an immanent system that is constantly overcoming its own limitations, and he contended that any political philosophy must turn on the analysis of capitalism and the ways it has developed. So for his part, Foucault refused to define his position or play the part of one who prescribes solutions. He regarded each of his books as an experiment that necessarily changed his own opinions. Thus, one should not expect post-structuralist views to contribute to any sort of canon, for such a canon does not exist. Post-structuralism instead begins from the position of destabilizing hierarchies of meanings, labels, knowledges, ideas, categories, and classifications, where the purpose is to challenge entrenched assumptions. Deconstruction affirms that any social text, whether spoken or written, contains implicit hierarchies, through which an order is imposed on reality, exercising a subtle repression, as these hierarchies exclude, subordinate, and hide various other potential meanings. This in itself, however, is the recognition of the existence of certain structures through the distinctions that we actually make, even if they are not given as natural material realities reflecting a so-called real world and only exist as abstractions produced by the systems of symbolization that we learn. Furthermore, poststructuralism welcomes a variety of perspectives to create multifaceted interpretations, even if these interpretations conflict with one another. So although poststructuralism is often seen as antagonistic to traditional Marxism, inasmuch as it is believed to mitigate against the grand theory claims and the macro phenomena level analysis adopted by Marxism, to focus upon the fragmentary, the incompleteness, the local, the indeterminate, and the partial nature of theory. So that's the point of poststructuralism. And so it might instead be understood as placing its theoretical attention on the social and political institutions that Marxists view as being determined by the economic, whereby the economic is not denied, but instead its libidinal and liminal formations are suggested. So the relationship between Marxism and poststructuralism then can be understood as a shared understanding of capitalism as a central problem, where both attempt to decode and destabilize the power relations of capitalist sort of axiomatics. In this sense, and notwithstanding the epistemological and ontological differences, Marxian political economy and post-structuralist perspectives are not necessarily incommensurable at all. And in fact, they remain, or the fact rather remains that Althusserian structuralist Marxism had a profound impact on thinkers we now call post-structuralist, as each came to terms with Marx in their own sort of distinct ways. So in Foucault's own words, he said, "One of the essential points of my intellectual formation is found also in reflecting on science and the history of science." But an analogous discourse also came out of the Marxist camp to the extent that Marxism claimed to be a science, or at least a general theory of the scientificity of science, a kind of tribunal of reason which would permit us to distinguish what was science from what was ideology. And I still recall the influence that Louis Althusser himself had on me in this regard. So in this sense, Foucault's entire philosophical project began from a critical reflection on Marxism and its ability or inability to offer a historical or a history of truth, where his intellectual course ran somewhat parallel to that of the existential Marxists until the early 1960s. Nonetheless, the materialist interpretation of history is one key feature of Marxism that many believe cannot be easily reconciled with poststructuralism. So poststructuralism is often said to establish an orientation towards history that denies material historical truth. Yet far from being a denial of temporality, it is instead to emphasize the forces that go beyond any telos of history that can be fully known, appreciated, and articulated by human actors. So while Foucault, for example, rejects Marxism as a particular theory of the mode of production and as a critique of political economy, he nonetheless forwards a critical view of domination, which, like historical materialism, recognizes all social practices as transitory and all intellectual formations as integral with power and social relations. Thus, although often critical of Marx, by Foucault's own admission, his approach also bears striking parallels to Marxism. In Foucault's rendering, the historical relativity of all systems and structures is recognized, so systems and structures, society, thought, theory, concepts, and so on, that the historical relativity of all these systems and structures is recognized alongside a materialism of physical necessities. So a discursive approach to Foucault thus represents a questioning of the very relation between structure and agency, which evokes a complementary between Marxian and post-structuralist thought. As such, Mark Poster contends that Foucault's approach understands discourse and practice as a couplet, which enables Foucault to search for the close connection between manifestations of reason and patterns of domination. Foucault can study the way in which discourse is not incoherent or non-structured, but shaped by practice without privileging any form of practice, such as class struggle. He can also study how discourse in turn shapes practice without privileging any form of discourse. In this sense, Foucault rejects Marx's understanding of historical materialism as a mechanism through which material or non-discursive practice is separated from discourse, and by which the latter is subsequently subordinated to the former. In contrast to Marx, then, the objective of Foucault's version of materialism as an archaeology of knowledge is to reveal relations between discursive formations and non-discursive domains. So here Foucault was talking about institutions, political events, economic practices and processes, wherein he said these rapprochements are not intended to uncover great cultural continuities, nor to isolate mechanisms of causality, nor does it seek to discover what is expressed in them. Instead, an archaeology of knowledge tries to determine how the rules of formation that govern it may be linked to non-discursive systems. It seeks to define specific forms of articulation. So for Foucault, unlike Marxian understandings, human destiny is not directed by a single set of factors, and is instead the forms of articulation and determination, or instead it looks to the forms of articulation and determination and how they may differ in relation to the relative importance of different non-discursive, in the sense, meaning material factors in terms of both place and time. So Foucault's approach to discourse as a coupling of practice is of paramount importance to understanding neoliberalism as a discourse for the central reasons of geography and history. So to get to an idea of neoliberalism as discourse, in other words, we need to think of the material sort of implications of discourse and attend to the history and the geography of how this idea has come to be. Given the increasing appreciation for how the geographic and temporal placement of performances of neoliberalism make a difference, hence the concept of neoliberalization replacing neoliberalism, it must be recognized that discourse did not have the same effects in any given location. So the discourse of neoliberalism here in Australia is different than the kind of the discourse of neoliberalism that's being evoked in Canada. And maybe Alistair will have something interesting to say afterwards about the way, he certainly opened my eyes to the way that neoliberal discourse is being mounted here in Australia, and its sort of co-optation of far-left anarchist sort of terminology, which is, maybe Alistair will speak to that afterwards, but I think it's a fascinating example of the contextual specificity of the discourse here in Australia. The critical importance then here is in wanting to avoid reducing all of the heterogeneities of neoliberalism involved to just discursive ones in the sense of language. So thereby overlooking neoliberalism's specific variations in conjunctural articulations with different sorts of material practices on the ground. So in other words, the reason perhaps why these terms have been co-opted in the Australian setting, there's perhaps a grounded rationale behind that, a very material reason perhaps for why that came to be. Okay, so an understanding of neoliberalism as discourse then is an approach that goes beyond simply the profusion and dissemination of languages that occurs either through hegemonic ideology or governmentality, and necessarily recognizes the material practices of state formation and policy and program, implementation, and the way that they characterize the specificities of actually existing neoliberalism on the ground, or neoliberalization in practice. In different geographical and institutional contexts, neoliberal discourse will circulate and function in variegated ways that intersect with the local culture and political economic circumstances to continually reconstitute the social. So this is not to treat the social as a residual effect of hegemonic processes and or governmental rationalities, as Clive Barnett worries, as neither the social nor hegemonic projects ever amount to a fully actualized material reality. If neoliberalism is to be understood as a discourse, the real world that both Castri and Barnett suppose neoliberalism is premised upon is an impossible contradiction of the symbolic and imaginary connotations of language. Again, this is not to deny materiality, but to recognize the material, or that the material and the discursive are always refracted through each other. And that's kind of if you're to take away sort of one key point, that's kind of a key point that I'm trying to make here in my argument, that the material and the discursive are always refracted through each other in terms of how neoliberalism as a discourse actually operates. And further, we can see that social practice itself is transitory, so that we can never quite put our finger on a distinctive historical materialism that can be pinned down as an actual so-called real world. Of course, Clive Barnett and Noel Castry take this notion of a real world from the literature on neoliberalism, but they never pause to problematize its application in the literature. Instead, they seem to replicate its possibility and focus their critiques on how their versions of a real world differ from those of other scholars concerned with neoliberalism or neoliberalization. Put differently, the structure of hegemony that neoliberalism as discourse seemingly invokes is only possible through the discourse of neoliberalism itself. There is no before discourse, and as the figure shows here, there's no point of entry. So if I go back to Jamie Peck's critique, well, you put this at the top and that at the bottom, I've said you can spin in this any which way. There is no entry point. I'm not showing a point of entry. But suggesting that there's no point of entry is not meant to imply an absence of a historical trajectory to the idea of neoliberalism. It's simply meant to, as a reconfigured understanding of historical materialism through a Foucauldian archaeology. So while Peck's account of the prehistories of neoliberalism and this idea of a proto-neoliberalism that he invokes, and he argues that there is, of course, then a historical lineage to the development of neoliberalism, the lack of an entry point here refers to the slow processes of discursive circulation that allowed a fringe utopian idea to congeal as a hegemonic imperative. So in Peck's argument, he talks about this trajectory of neoliberalism starting as a very fringe idea. So coming from somewhere, there is a history then, but there's no ideational flashpoint, to use Peck's terms. So this, he talks about an immaculate sort of conception to neoliberalism. There is no immaculate conception. It was formed out of other discourses that sort of mutated into a neoliberal discourse. So rejecting this sort of flashpoint idea, the circuitous paths of neoliberalism have no precise discernible beginning because it's impossible to disentangle them from previous ideologies and previous discourses. In this sense, neoliberalism in general is simply a semiotic sign of neoliberalization, so the unfolding ongoing process itself, as it is necessarily something that stands for something else to someone in some capacity. For its part, the social is always a figment of the self, which is not a coherent entity, but a constitution of conflicting tensions and knowledge claims. In short, the social and the self are mutually constituted through discourse. Accordingly, what we are left with are rearticulations and representations of neoliberal discourse in the form of particular discourses of neoliberalization, where individual actors take a proactive role in reshaping the formal practices and politics, policy and administration that comprise the dynamics and rhythms of sociocultural change. There is no presentation or constitution, in other words, only representation or representation and reconstitution. Because as we produce social texts, we actually create meaning. So I'm using Judith Butler's term here in terms of thinking of this as a discursive performativity then. And she argues that a discursive performativity appears to produce that which it names, to enact its own referent, to name and to do, to name and to make, generally speaking, a performative functions to produce that which it declares. So the issue is not about a purported reality of scientific truths where neoliberalism is seen as an end, but the interpretation of cultural constructs, where neoliberalism becomes seen as a means. The implications for the current neoliberal moment is that it is just that, a transitory moment on its way to becoming something else. So just as neoliberalism as a discourse sort of evolved out of other discourses, so too will it eventually evolve into something that no longer resembles what we consider today as neoliberalism. So there's hope to be found in that idea. Okay. While there is no perceptible line in the sands of history where neoliberalism will categorically end, the patterns of contextually specific discourses of neoliberalization will inevitably and eventually mutate into something that no longer has a resemblance to the neoliberalism in general that we conceive here in 2016. The question then, provoked by Barnett and Castry, is, does neoliberalism in general ever exist? And the answer that I would venture is yes, but like anything that we can name, and even things that we can touch, like water, to revisit Castry's peculiar analogy, they are always and only understood as representations through the performative repercussions of discourse itself. So some of you might contend that this caveat amounts to a no, a fancy way of saying no, but I still think it's a yes. But I think the only way you could be correct in thinking this would be a no is if neoliberalism in general is understood as a real world referent, which is something that I've been arguing against. It's only materialized through discourse, and it is discourse itself that allows it to materialize. Again, the rejection of an assumed real world does not refuse a certain materiality then to neoliberalism or other phenomena, but instead recognizes materialism in the Foucauldian sense of an archaeology of knowledge, whereby discourse and practice, or theory and event, become inseparable. Thus, recognizing neoliberalism as a general form becomes possible once we consider it through its discursive formation, whereby the four understandings of neoliberalism are read as an ongoing reconstitution of a particular political rationality, to use Wendy Brown's term. Far from negating the need for resistance to neoliberalism, recognizing neoliberalism as a representation still requires social struggle. Moreover, and notwithstanding Gibson Graham's criticism, the building of transnational solidarity through a larger conversation is also needed because such activity hastens the pace at which neoliberalism may recede into historical obscurity and be replaced with a new discourse, a novel representation that we can hope produces a more egalitarian social condition. So we're not stuck with neoliberalism as a discourse, in other words, that we can willfully mutate and shift this discourse. And the more social protest and activism that we engage with, this changes the stakes, right? It provides a counter discourse, but a discourse that can also attach itself to this discourse and help in its mutation towards something else. Contestation then actively works towards and opens pathways to achieving a goal of transforming and moving beyond neoliberalism. And while discourse may for a time reinscribe the power of particular logics, Foucault insists that no discourse is ever guaranteed. So while particular discourses prevail in some spaces, the potential for meanings to shift or for subaltern discourses to unsettle the orthodoxy remains. Again, hope to be found in that. And you've been very patient, and this brings me to the conclusion. So, in arguing for an understanding of neoliberalism as discourse, I don't presume that comprehending neoliberalism separately as a hegemonic ideology, as a policy and program, as a state form, or as a form of governmentality is wrong or not useful. I think there's a lot of useful literature and a great deal of work has been done in each of these categories, and it's contributed a lot to our understanding of how neoliberalism actually functions. So instead, I've simply attempted to provoke some consideration for the potential potential to reconcile the different approaches to neoliberalism. My argument then should be interpreted as an effort to destabilize the ostensible incompatibility that some scholars undertaking their separate usage seem to assume. Without at least attempting to reconcile these four approaches, we risk being deprived of a coherent concept with which to work, and thus concede some measure of credibility to Clive Barnett's claim that there's no such thing as neoliberalism. So such a position renders the entire body of scholarship on neoliberalism questionable, as scholars cannot be sure that they are even discussing the same thing. More perilously, to accept such a claim throws the project of constructing solidarities across space into an uneasy quandary, where the resonant violent geographies of our current moment may go unnoticed, a condition that plays perfectly into the ideological denial maintained by the current capitalist order. So in ignoring such relational possibilities for resistance, the contemporary zeitgeist, resistance to this contemporary zeitgeist, Barnett seems keen to engage in a project of disarticulation. Yet such deconstruction, I think, is meant to be interruptive, not debilitating. As Spivak contends, deconstruction does not say there is no subject, that there is no truth, that there is no history. It is constantly and persistently looking into how truths are formed. And so it is about noticing what we inevitably leave out, even leave out of even the most searching and inclusive accounts of phenomena like neoliberalism. And as we search for what's actually missing from our conceptualization, we open up the potential for new discursive understandings. Rather than making nice symmetrical accounts of the real at the meeting point of representational performance and structural forces, neoliberalism, understood as a discourse, is attuned to processual interpretation and ongoing debate. So while there are inevitable tensions between the four views of neoliberalism that are not entirely commensurable, their content is not diametrically opposed. And indeed, a considered understanding of how power similarly operates in both a Gramscian sense of hegemony and in a Foucauldian sense of governmentality points towards a dialectical, or maybe a quadrilectical, I don't even know if that's a word, but you get the idea of all four components coming together in a relationship. Understanding neoliberalism as a discourse allows then for a much more integral approach to social relations than speech performances alone. This is a discourse that encompasses material forms in state formation and through policy and program, and via the subjectification of individuals on the ground, even if this articulation still takes place through discursive performatives. So by formulating discourse in this fashion, we need not revert to a supposed real-world referent to recognize a materiality that is both constituted by and constitutive of discourse. Instead, materiality and discourse become integral, where one cannot exist without the other. And it is precisely this understanding of discourse then that points to a similarity then between post-structuralism and Marxian political economy approaches and their shared concern for the relations of power. So I don't want to conclude that I have worked through all of these tensions, and my ambition has actually been much more humble than that. Instead, I've simply sought to open up an avenue for dialogue between scholars on either side of the political economy post-structuralist divide. And the importance of bridging this gap is commensurate with the role of the intellectual, in Foucault's words, in shaking up habits, ways of acting and thinking, of dispelling common sense and commonplace beliefs, and of taking a new measure of rules and institutions and participating in the formation of a political will. Such reflexivity necessarily involves opening ourselves to the possibility of finding common ground between the epistemic and ontological understandings of political economy and post-structuralism so that together they may assist in disestablishing neoliberalism's rationalities, deconstructing its strategies, disassembling its technologies, and ultimately destroying its techniques. In changing our minds then, so too might we change the world. Thank you.
Questions. I'll just ask for, I'll come down here so I can see them, show of hands, and I'll attempt to get around to everyone. Nandita.
Hi Simon, thanks for being at the top. I was wondering, you said about, you know, Foucault's understanding of discourse as there is a link between discourse and practice, you know, in terms of the institutions and the techniques. Wondering, is there any midpoint between looking at Lacan and Mouffe understanding of, you know, discursive and non-discursive, where they have rejected this idea of Foucault, where he makes a distinction between discursive and non-discursive? When you look at their understanding of how neoliberalism can work in terms of what they have talked about as hegemony, as a discourse, and you know how it can lead to a socialist strategy.
Yeah, well, I haven't specifically, but it sounds like a great paper, right? That that you could certainly bring that in as another example of a way to bring a material and a discursive sense to neoliberalism together, right? And so, I mean, my reading of Foucault is that he doesn't actually separate discursive and non-discursive. I mean, he does, I suppose in a certain way he does, but his version of discourse is often used, that implied within that is a certain sense of materiality to begin with. So I think, you know, within Moose's work, that there's lots of possibility to play off Foucault's conceptualization, but maybe to take it even a little bit further, as you say, to really tease out what are the materialities then that come of the particular kinds of discourses that are being mounted. Within my own work, most of my empirical work has been in the Cambodian context, and that's some of what I've tried to unpack in the Cambodia's particular and hybridized, mutated version of neoliberalism, the way that certain discourses are circulating within that society, and the way that they are being mobilized, and the kind of material practices that then come out of them. And in particular, I'm just thinking about the way, at the sort of global level, the idea of neoliberalism as interspatial competition between cities, and the way that that's been refracted through Phnom Penh, but the way that then is articulated on the ground in Cambodian society is, very anti-poor, very anti-rural, very anti-homeless in particular. So I've been doing a lot of work with homeless people in Phnom Penh and thinking of the ways that these neoliberal discourses at the global level have been adopted into a local frame, and how that intersects with the existing political, economic, and institutional frameworks within the country, and then manifests itself quite violently onto the lives of homeless people. So not using Laclau and Moof's work to do that, but nonetheless an attempt to bring the material and the discursive together and show that, that these are, again, an integral sort of process that's playing out. Yeah.
Frank.
Thanks. My question relates to dialectics and contradiction. You finished by claiming that there can be a dialectical relationship between the discourse and the materiality. Yet the analysis you presented with doesn't seem to contain, to my way of thinking, sufficient emphasis on contradictory elements. Indeed, this beautiful little chart you presented us with shows mutually reinforcing elements. It's a beautiful pattern of buttresses. But if the purpose of a neoliberal discourse, for those who want to change the world, is to provide some sort of common focus for disparate radical groups, each of which is focusing on contradictory elements within the economy and society, you would want to represent the relationships in a rather different way, would you not? In terms of a set of contradictions rather than a sense of mutually reinforcing elements. I wonder, I'd be interested in your response to that.
Yeah, I mean, there could be a diagram can only do so much, right?
Yeah.
And I'm actually really bad at diagrams. I kind of thought of this, and I did it on chicken scratch, sort of on a piece of paper, and my brother actually made it fancy to look like that. So, I mean, the arrows could be more squiggly, but within any one of these arrows, there are contradictions in the way that works, right? That as the as with any discourse, as it circulates, I mean, I just remember as a child in school playing the telephone game. Does everybody remember that game? You go around a table and you whisper to your friend, the teacher will give you a statement to start with, and you go around the table and you whisper it to each person next to you, and by the time you get back to the end, it's totally changed, right? Whatever that phrase was is something different. And I think through this process, those kind of contradictions come up, right? And it's through the kinds of contestation that are engaged, which aren't, you're right, aren't necessarily represented in this diagram, so perhaps there could be a companion piece diagram that similarly shows the circuitous nature of contestation and contradiction, which is infused then within this diagram. I don't know how you conceptually represent that, right? But certainly this is not, I mean, my point with thinking of neoliberalism as discourse is not to reconstruct neoliberalism as monolithism, right? That discourse is, and I think I talked about this in the paper itself, is that discourse is contestable, right? It is something that is constantly shifting and constantly changing. So even as clean as this might look, there are necessarily contradictions imbued within it. Within any one of these little arrows, you can find a host of contradictions. As it rubs up, in particular, as a geographer, the way I think of this is rubbing up against the friction of grounded empirical realities, right? So the work that I'm doing in Cambodia, where we have a system where patron-client relations are, you know, the key sort of feature of the local political economy. How does neoliberalism then operate in that kind of a context? And the answer is in very peculiar and interesting ways, as it meets the friction against those patterns of organization. So it has to mutate and adapt accordingly. So that's neoliberalism's adaptation. But of course, you're right. We as individual actors have, and as you know, individual actors who like to come together as, you know, and represent forms of solidarity, that we have ways that we can create friction for neoliberalism as well. And certainly, yeah, not to undermine the potentiality of that at all, but you've given me food for thought that maybe there's a second diagram to go with it.
I have a question. I'm taking other people for the speaking list, if you might want to think about your question while I'm asking this one. So, well, first, thanks for your talk, Simon. And I really like the goal of your project of trying to think through a way of by which post-structuralist and Marxist forms of analysis can be fused or synthesised in general, and of neoliberalism in particular. So I've got a two-part question, but they're related, and it relates to partly to the diagram. You said in your talk that in this diagram and in your analysis of neoliberalism, there's no point of entry. My response to that is, don't you, as a scholar of neoliberalism, as someone who's active against neoliberalism, don't you need to have a point of entry? If you're trying to understand the origins of neoliberalism, you need an entry point. So my question would be, what is your analytical starting point in mounting this analysis? I mean, in general, and then of neoliberalism in particular. Related to that, in this diagram, one thing that I can see that's missing potentially, that's presumably central to a Marxist analysis, and which I don't think is captured sufficiently by the neoliberalism as ideological hegemonic project label, which is used to encapsulate the Marxist analysis of neoliberalism, is the production of value and the conditions under which that's produced. And I say that's important because surely that provides the crucial context in which all of these other elements are embedded. And so where would that fit within this diagram, do you think, and in an attempt to reconcile Marxism with post-structuralist forms of analysis?
Yeah, so the first part of your question, I mean, I think I said in the talk that no point of entry, but not to deny a historical trajectory to neoliberalism. So the reason why I would say no point of entry, because any discourse that we have in the present moment is just a continuation of other discourses in a way, right? So, I mean, I often get the question, well, why neoliberalism, why not capitalism? Particularly by, you know, people on the far left. Shouldn't we be saying rallying against capitalism rather than neoliberalism? And my answer is, well, it's, you know, it's the same thing, just neoliberalism is the contemporary iteration of capitalism in its most sort of vibrant and powerful form, if you will, now zombified form, so I don't know if that counts as vibrant anymore, but it's the contemporary iteration. So when I say there's no entry point to this. I mean, you know, if we go back to the, I mean, Peck and a number of others have identified, you know, the Mont Pelerin Society and various particular moments when the word neoliberalism was coined, this kind of a historical trajectory. But these discussions didn't originate out of thin air, right? They didn't, it wasn't just as though somebody was plopped down from the sky and said, bing, neoliberalism, right? That these were conversations that were ongoing about, you know, forms of capitalism prior to the neoliberal sort of turn. So engaging with the welfare state and Keynesianism and all these other sort of ideas surrounding how capitalism could be formed, and you know, going back to feudalism even, this is an ongoing conversation that's been happening, you know, among different human beings for all, you know, as long as human beings have been communicating with each other. So to carve it out as a particular neo moment where neoliberalism as discourse came on the stage, maybe, I mean, if you wanted to identify it as the moment somebody said, ooh, neoliberalism, and coined a term, I just think that's problematic because that wasn't even actually the origin, right? And even the Mont Pelerin Society and the various sort of early iterations where folks got together decidedly to produce this kind of a project, that the conversations were even happening before that. And in thinking of a way, and the reason why I'm wanting to think of it in those sort of terms is in thinking of a way out, right? Is that I actually don't think it's going to be, and here's where, you know, some of my anarchist philosophy comes in, as I don't believe in the idea of a Marxian revolution where all that is solid melts into air and suddenly, hooray, neoliberalism is dead and the giant is slain sort of thing. That I think of it as a more, you know, that the process of space and time is more processual than that. And our exit plan from neoliberalism is to continually shift the discourse, which isn't to undermine, again, the kinds of protests and forms of solidarity that are being engaged on the street, that those are critically important as materializations that refract within and ultimately change the discourse. But I think it is the discourse itself that is going to shift and move away from neoliberalism. And there's already, you know, there's been a lot of momentum towards that, things like the Occupy movement and, you know, the financial crisis of 2008 gave a little bit of a kick in the butt to that as well, but it's come back in various other ways. So to continually to mobilize on the ground through material practices helps to shift this discourse away from what it is. And there will ultimately come a time where it, again, no longer resembles what we're currently talking about now. That it is, hopefully, you know, it might be shifting so much more for the worse, but hopefully it'll be shifting so much more for the better that we're no longer having this discussion about neoliberalism. Okay, so the second part, in terms of production of value, I mean, in some ways, I could respond by saying, well, maybe it could be another sort of a fifth category within that, because there are people writing particularly around this idea of the production of value. But then at the same time, I mean, I think it fits at a lot of places within a circuitous notion of neoliberalism, right? That value production goes on in different ways, that states reform themselves as a way to produce more value in a certain sense, and policies and programs are put into play for that particular purpose, that individual actors rationalize themselves as value producing, or are mobilized in that way subjectified in such a way that maybe they're not necessarily aware of that, but certainly that's how they're being mobilized. And in terms of an ideological hegemonic project, if you want to think of it as that, then I mean, certainly there's a lot of agents who, that's their modus operandi, right, is to extract value from a system as much as they can and to collect it. But yeah, I mean, again, the limitations of a diagram, I often don't use diagrams for that reason, but I mean, you listened to the talk and I was sort of, and the reason I made this diagram is because as I was writing it out, when I was writing this paper, it's like, wow, that looks really messy. What am I actually meaning here? And then just started to map it out and put it down as such to try and make it slightly more digestible, the kind of the messy, if you will, but circuitous kind of thinking that I was trying to imply in an understanding of neoliberalism as discourse.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. I've got Matt, Tim. Are there any other people who have questions at this stage? Matt.
Just a quick question. It's quite a common format for people to write, you know, this particular explanation of neoliberalism is wrong, and I think that this other one is a better one. So I quite like that this isn't quite as negative as that's looking towards synthesis. But my question is, whilst you're arguing that all of these are correct ways to think about neoliberalism in their own way, are there still incorrect ways to think about neoliberalism?
Well, there's one big incorrect way to think about neoliberalism, right? And that is to think that neoliberalism is going to produce, you know, as the discourse itself represents, that neoliberalism will lead to this global, you know, harmonious global village sort of end state where everything is wonderful and la-di-da. We see the material realities of neoliberalism prove this discourse wrong time and time again, right? So there's the one quintessential incorrect way, I think, of thinking of neoliberalism. And yeah, I mean, I'll wear my politics on my sleeve there and won't mince words that's, to me, it's categorically wrong, and it's not just about me and what I think either, that, you know, the millions and millions of people who have been marginalized and set aside and, you know, thrown on the rubbish heap, so to speak, that is the all the proof you need to understand that, you know, those who espouse this discourse have got it wrong. But at the same time, there's very few people who identify as neoliberals either, right? That they don't, nobody stands up and says, hey, I'm a neoliberal sort of thing, that this is a discourse that's been largely mobilized on the left to define a certain kind of condition. And if you ask what I would call a neoliberal, are you a neoliberal, they'd probably say, huh, what, like, what's a neoliberal? Maybe now the discourse has become powerful enough that they hear sort of the critiques that are going on the left, but I don't think they would ever self-identify in such a fashion. I don't know, have you come across, Damien, anyone who's willing to stand up and say, hey, I'm a card-carrying neoliberal, so to speak?
They're liberals.
Yeah.
Self-identifying.
Yeah.
Typically.
Yeah. So, yeah.
But you gave us the answer.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I suppose I would identify some as well, but they don't call themselves neoliberals. They call themselves anarcho-capitalists, which I think are not actually neoliberals. They're neo-neoliberals instead.
Tim,
you're up. Yeah, so Alexander Hollenheim once claimed, quite controversially, that feminism and Marxism are one, and that one is Marxism. Her point being that, well, feminism is a good project in her view, not a view that I necessarily agree with. It can be subsumed within Marxism. I kind of feel like you've done that, or attempted to do that, to Marxism. And I was trying to pin down exactly what it was that was missing, when it occurred to me, partly on the basis of Damien's comment about value production, that not only is there no reference to value production in your diagram, but there doesn't seem to be any reference to anything specifically economic at all. Every single box and arrow on that diagram, as far as I can see, could potentially refer to something outside of the sphere of the economy. If there were an alien, for example, who didn't know what neoliberalism was and thought maybe, for example, it's a theory about law and order, which it partially is, that they can look at that and they wouldn't be any the wiser on that. There's nothing about global supply chains, there's nothing about austerity economics, and it just kind of seems to me that is kind of a symptom of the core of Marxism being missing from that diagram and perhaps from the project more broadly.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a Marxist, so there's at least part of the explanation for that. So, and basically I'm, you know, taking the ideological hegemonic project from the literature itself. So these are categories that I've come across in the literature, and again, Ward and England are the ones who sort of mapped out the four trajectories, and prior to that, Wendy Larner again had suggested three, but I think she left out policy and program as one specific form, but so many geographers have been talking about policy and program that Ward and England eventually picked it up. But anyways, in terms of economy itself, you know, economics, what are economics but a particular form of power relations, right? So that's where I would situate any sort of economic question, and that's kind of the way, and perhaps that's the influence of post-structuralism speaking in my own work, is to frame it in that kind of sense, which...
Don't you think there's something sort of fundamentally economic about neoliberalism?
Yeah, I mean, there certainly is an economic component to neoliberalism, no doubt about it. But I also think that I think neoliberalism as an idea, the way, and particularly the way that scholars have been working with it, it's by no means only economic, right? And therein would be my critique of this idea that feminism might be subsumed into...
Well, but I don't think that. I'm just saying that's kind of what you would lean to.
Yeah, but that would be my critique then, is that that Marxism has a certain privileging of the economic over other kinds of categories, right? And so that it is about class, you know, the fundamental sort of subject position that we should be concerned about is the idea of class and the worker itself, rather than from a feminist perspective, it's more about gender and race, ethnicity, the intersectionality of ideas coming together, which is something that I think anarchism is a little more able to encompass, is the broader sort of holistic perspective. But it's not to deny that there is no economic component to that, but again, not to privilege that. And the way that neoliberalism has been taken up in the literature, I mean, discussions of neoliberalism and sexuality, for example, that a lot of this, I mean, there's intersections with economics, inevitably so, but a lot of the discussion is around, you know, the category of the self, the individual, right? And the way that the individual and the embodiment of that individual is transformed through particular neoliberal rationalities. But yeah, I mean, I'm happy for that kind of critique. There's, you know, there's ample room for critique, and that's the sort of risk of attempting a synthesis of this sort, is that I don't think you'll ever fully satisfy anybody, because it's like a post-structuralist. If there's a post-structuralist in the room, they could say, well, you haven't properly represented the specific nuances of performativity in terms of the way that this diagram is constructed as well. And, you know, it's never going to satisfy everyone. And indeed, you know, going back to Jamie Peck and some of the conversations I had with him about this diagram, is he kind of looked at it and said, well, you're a fence sitter, then you're sitting somewhere in the middle of all of this, and you're going to get these kind of critiques from scholars who espouse these different positions, and how will you reconcile those? And it's my point is not necessarily to, you know, I said at the outset and at the end that it's a more humble approach. I don't consider myself having worked out all the tensions or the nuances, but here's an indication of potentially where we might be able to go in thinking through, you know, what are some of the useful ways to think about how these things might work together, and what kind of analyses might be drawn out of thinking of the connections between these various formations or understandings of neoliberalism in the literature. So. Yeah, certainly not beyond critique, and if you'd like to see more economics in there, then, you know, you're free to take your own pen and draw economics into some of the boxes and some of the arrows, and think of how it might actually work. Like what are the economic relations, in other words, then, between policy and program and state form, or governmentality and hegemonic project, and so on and so forth. Yeah.
I've got three people on the speaker list. We've got 6 minutes left, so I might just ask each of the questioners to give their questions in turn, and then Simon just answer them all as a
sure.
Begin. So I've got over here, up the back, and then Frank.
Oh, Simon, hey, thank you.
looking at the scheme and following your arguments, I get this image of this great vehicle moving through time and space and evolving, mutating. But following on Frank's comments, and someone else made a comment about like Lou and Wolf, what's missing, I find, is the antagonism and the violence that's involved in this mutation. And it also reminds me of a seminar that was held here not long ago about Syria, about the civil war, and where neoliberalism was a key component of the policy of the state. And to me, that's the problem. And so that evolution, mutation, is full of antagonism and conflict. And that's, to me, this what's missing in your scheme.
Up the back under the projector.
Yeah, I mean, it falls quite nicely off this question, but I'd be interested to know what you make of the anthropologist David Graeber's argument about the connection between post-structuralism and neoliberalism, because he also draws connection, but in quite a different way, and he speaks in terms of the sort of the moment at which neoliberalism started to have its greatest effects on the university, in terms of professionalisation, scholarship, and sort of the increasing precarity of academic work. And he says that it's precisely at that moment that post-structuralism becomes so popular, because it has it's so good at describing that experience. Things like governmentality are really good at speaking to things like, say, order culture. But perhaps what post-structuralism is less good at doing is speaking to people's experience outside of that system, and, you know, particularly people for whom direct forms of violence still matter, and it's at a moment when these direct forms of violence play an increasingly integral role in the function of capitalism, which is sort of his point. So it'd be interesting to know what you make of that, both as a scholar and maybe in terms of your work in Cambodia.
I don't know whether I should really have a second bite at the cherry, but I just wanted to say one brief thing as a follow-up to Tim's comment, to point out that in Australia, before the term neoliberalism became commonplace, economic rationalism was the local term. And so I think the origins in a concern about economic matters are very pertinent. But my question is more about the Cathy Gibson-Graham line in the end of Capitalism, where they argue against using capitalism as a totalizing discourse, tends to be disempowering, such a big system, you know, the chance of actually changing it is so remote, you know, we should stop talking about it if we really want to effect social change. Could you say the same thing about neoliberalism?
Yeah, so I think three questions come together around somewhat of a common theme. And so I'll start with the final question in that, and then get to the other questions. But, you know, I thought Damien introduced that the paper Fuck Neoliberalism that I recently wrote was basically thinking through all of this discussion about neoliberalism and kind of my fatigue with the discourse itself, right? And wanting, you know, thinking, is there... are Gibson and Graham onto something, right? And so, in some ways, you know, I say in that paper that I originally maybe thought of titling it "Forget Neoliberalism" instead, but I think there's a danger in doing that as well. I think there's certainly a danger in continually to discursively reproduce it time and time again. That certainly, you know, each of us is guilty in some sense of recapitulating this discourse and this idea that we all have been made subjects of it, but we all have participated in a performative way of reproducing it through our economic rationalizations, if you will. But the danger of just simply stopping using the term, I think, is then, one, the way that we might be able to think about solidarities across space, right? To think about, you know, what's happening here in Australia, and, you know, in my time here, I've been here, I think, 2 weeks now, and met with people at various universities, and learning just how profound neoliberalism has got its hooks into Australian academia, as bad as I thought it was in Canada, it seems that much worse here. So what kinds of solidarities can be built across space? What can we learn from each other? And how can we productively resist this, you know, seemingly monolithic discourse to shrink it down into something that is no longer monolithic? But that's one of the dangers if we deny talking about it in that sense. And also what we deny is the violence of neoliberalism, which then goes, I think, to the other two questions. And really, I mean, it's not something that I've ignored in my work at all. If Damien introduced one of my books from last year, is called Violent Neoliberalism, and talking about the experience of neoliberalism in Cambodia. There's also, I mean, I've before I was even a scholar of neoliberalism per se, I was a scholar of violence and the geographies of violence. And it was looking at geographies of violence in Cambodia that sort of a connection with the type of neoliberalism that's playing out on the ground in Cambodia. And coming to think now of neoliberalism not only as a discourse, but neoliberalism as a very particular form of violence itself, right? And so empirically, I've drawn that out in Cambodia, but theoretically, I've done some work around that as well. To plug the handbook of neoliberalism, I have a chapter in there. That's the title of the chapter, is The Violence of Neoliberalism, where I work through in a more theoretical sense the way that I think that violence and neoliberalism map onto each other. So in this particular paper, in this talk, I mean, certainly that I could have perhaps said a lot more about violence and within, I mean, this is kind of the rationality, the discourse of neoliberalism itself, which never presents itself as a violent enterprise, right? The discourse is in fact, if I'm to think then of historical trajectories as well, one of the arguments I make in the Violence of Neoliberalism paper is that neoliberalism, I think, is reactionary in some ways to violence and presents itself in the aftermath of the two world wars. It presented itself as a solution to violence, which is obscene in the current context, given all the violence that it mets out, right? But that's what it thought of itself as, a salve for this kind of problematic in the global playing field. So definitely there is a great deal of violence imbued within neoliberalism that can't be mistaken, which is why we need to continue to confront the bull by the horns, so to speak. In terms of David Graeber's work and his contentions, I mean, I think, you know, the importance of that kind of critique is, again, to look to the violence and the ways that it sort of manifests itself. And I think, you know, Graeber is an anarchist and identified as such. And so the other thing I'll say is that, you know, I identify in as an anarchist in my own work as well, and have used anarchist philosophy. And the way I came to that, to an anarchist understanding, is one, through my work in Cambodia, where a Marxian approach never, I could never reconcile that given the experience of the Khmer Rouge, but two, looking at violence in particular and the violence of neoliberalism. And what we typically hear about anarchism is that it's a synonym for violence and chaos and these sorts of things. But in doing work, I came to an anarchist perspective from looking explicitly at violence and wanting to find pathways out of violence, and found that the most interesting work being done on non-violence and peaceful sort of trajectories was, surprise, anarchist philosophers. To the point now that I actually take anarchism as a synonym for non-violence. That's my understanding of the term, which flips the mainstream media's view entirely on its head. And you know, I don't think I have time to get into all of that here, but if you read some of my other work on, to plug another book, I've got another book coming out next month called The Anarchist Roots of Geography, where I go into the sort of nuances of anarchism and violence. And the one statement I'll make is, if you look at the long course of history, the violence that's been done by so-called statists as opposed to anarchists is quite profound, the comparison, right? That anarchists look extremely peaceful in comparison to the genocides and wars that have been conducted in the name of the state. So Graeber, for his part, I think that's his concern to an extent, is with you know, the phenomena of violence in a lot of his work. In particular, the critique of post-structuralism. I mean, yeah, there's some anarchists who have been quite at loggerheads with a post-structuralist critique, but there's some who have openly embraced post-structuralism to the point where people like Saul Newman and Todd May are talking about a post-anarchism, which isn't to mean beyond anarchism, but to mean the suturing together of post-structuralism and anarchism. So does post-structuralism necessarily translate into academia going crazy, so to speak, and mutating into this grotesque neoliberal formation? You know, I think that's a coincidence. It's perhaps an interesting one, but I wouldn't lay the blame at the foot of post-structuralists for that one. I would, you know, I'd lay the blame where it probably belongs, is at the foot of the administrative class. Maybe that's a Marxian ghost speaking inside of me, I don't know, but the administrative class in universities, as we know, has just been intensifying where, you know, there's no longer positions for academics, but if you're an administrator, there's all kinds of positions for you. So that's kind of this corporate kind of logic that's congealed itself with the academy is where the problem comes from. Yeah. Which is itself its own form of violence against academia, right? Where magazines like Quadrant can come out and say, you know, cut the arts and cut social scientists because all people do within those domains is rubbish. When in reality, you know, those of us in the social sciences and in the arts are trying to be the engine of emancipation for society and the social conscience for that society, in a society that is in desperate need of having a social conscience at this point. But, yeah.
All right, we've come to the end of our time. We're going to be kicked out soon. On that point, one of the latest jobs advertised at the University of Sydney is in human relations, human resources, specialising in change management, i.e. making people redundant. So, exactly.